I figure you could probably do a better job of telling about yourself than I could. Could you just give us a quick background on yourself here?
Well, I'm a male. Now, I was born and raised in Southeast Kansas, where I am now. I bought a little ranch back here. And as I'm growing older, I like to spend time out here. And but yeah, I grew up in, on a pig farm. My dad had real bad problems from World War II. You know, they call it PTSD now and stuff like that. So we grew up dirt poor, and I was a big kid, like real big kid. And it's a good thing because I had to work hard. So, but I went to grade school at this little Catholic school around the corner here, and it was taught by nuns. And when they, my mom brought me into, and I had three older brothers, and they'd already been in, they're already in that school over there, whatever it was. And then I show up, and the nun, one first nun took a look at me, and she said, "Ooh, what a big one." And I went, "Mom, get me the hell out of here." And, but anyway, she said I was too big to play with the other kids, so she didn't give me no recess my first year of grade school. So, they had a trunk, and it was full of these little books, and these books were all like one-man skits. So they just had me doing one-man skits to entertain them while all my buddies were all out in the yard playing. My brother came home one day from the city dump when we were kids, because that's where we got most of our toys and stuff, and he had a TV, and we got it hooked up, and there was a show on called The Whirly Birds. A guy who played Vestas in Gunsmoke. I don't know this old stuff. Anyway, it was my brother was saying, "Well, those guys make good money at that." And I was sitting there, and I goes, "Well, you know, I do that all the time at school." Not by choice, but... So anyway, so then I said, "Well, you know, one of these days I'm going to try that." And so, and then I went to... graduated out of that little school with four kids, and there was four kids in my class, and we went to this unified district school, and they was like 100 and I don't know 10 or 15 kids in my class, and you know, 500 or 600 all through those schools. That was kind of a shock or whatever it is. And anyway, I signed up for football, basketball, and track because I wanted to take showers, because we didn't have any running water or anything like that at our place. And you know, so I signed up, and anyway, I became like the number one tackle in the state of Kansas, and I got all kinds of scholarship offers and all kinds of stuff. And anyway, then the draft kind of got in the road of that, and during the Vietnam era, and then so anyway, I learned how to do construction, and the first chance I got, I went out to California and started searching things out, and you know, figuring out how to make a living and all that stuff, and then got into doing building sets for theater group, and with the idea that, you know, I could get on the stage, you know. And sure enough, one of the directors asked me to do a part in a play, and I kind of like took the play over, and then the next thing you know, they told me to star in a play, and I starred in Bus Stop, and then some other producers and directors were there at the show because it was getting great reviews at the LA Times. And next thing you know, I started making, you know, 10 years later, I started making a living at it, you know. And I was doing Action Jackson before I, that was another one of Joel Silver's film. I did that one. Then Joel just took me right out of that and put me right into Die Hard, you know. And that that's a, you know, a classic movie. It's Bruce's T-shirts in the Smithsonian and the... and the movie itself went into the National Archives about 2 years ago. So that's pretty impressive.
And how did you hear about Die Hard? Like you said, was it because of your connection with Joel that you were told to audition for that? Or
I didn't have to audition for it. I just finished doing Action Jackson. And they when they send a movie out to do a trailer, the teaser for the movie, for the theaters, and for, you know, now the internet, whatever it is, it's a non-biased group that looks at the footage, and then they pick out the scenes and edit the the trailer together for the movie. And all these movies, a lot of these movies I was doing was, even if they were just small parts, for some reason they was always putting my face in the trailer. So when they made the first cut for Action Jackson, when you ran it, it looked like I starred in it. You know, and Joel couldn't help but, you know, see my face everywhere. So when Die Hard came along, I got a call and to go down to 20th Century Fox, because Jackie Birch wanted to called me, and she was the casting agent for Die Hard. And anyway, so I showed up and I walked in Joel's office, and she's standing there, and she handed me a script and said, you're reading for the part of Eddie. And then Joel looked up from his desk and started yelling at her. He goes, he doesn't have to read for me. He's a star of Action Jackson. And so he started yelling at Jackie. I said, oh, no, this ain't good. This is good. She's never going to ask me out for anything, because you don't want to be yelled at. So anyway, that was it. And I didn't have to do anything. It was just, you know, they handed me this script. And that was a quick little story on that script was, when I first got it, I got killed about a third of the way through the movie. Oh, really? And I was going, oh, man, what a great. When I read the script, I said, this is going to be a major hit. You know, I can just tell by the story. It's just awesome. You know, all I got to do is stick to the screenplay, and they got a hit. And they did. By fate, I ran into this lady through a friend of mine who was an agent for Herbie Hancock and some big musicians' names or whatever it was. And I just asked her by curiosity. I was just talking to her in the hallway at the record studio. And I said, you ever handle actors in your PR firm? And she said, no. She says, but I've always thought about it. And I said, well, I'm getting to the point in my career I could use some PR. And she goes, well, what have you done? And I said, I was naming off Murphy's Law with Charlie Bronson. And I just finished Slam Dance with Tom Hulce and some other stuff. And I said, oh, yeah, Action Jackson. And I said, you know, I just got cast about a week ago in a movie called Die Hard. And she says, well, my future brother-in-law is the writer of that. And I said, well, why don't you tell your future brother-in-law to take Eddie's part and make sure that he's the last guy that gets killed in that group. And I'll hire you as my publicist. And she goes, I'll see what I can do. And so she went and talked to Stephen DeSouza, and Stephen said, yeah, that's not a big deal. That's how I ended up being got Bruce Willis's last bullet in that movie. It's because, yeah, I spoke up. I've done that in several films. One of them called Revenge of the Highway was a TV movie of the week with Craig Baxley or whatever it was. When they wrap you, you know, and you're in New Mexico staying in a nice hotel getting food and per diem money and everything, you hate to have to leave, you know. So I just walked up to him and walking by him and the producer in my last scene, and I said, wouldn't that be something if this character showed up in that bar scene at the end of the show, whatever it was. Then I just walked off, and the next couple hours later, the director came over to me and says, I just talked to the director about it, and I think that's a great idea. And can you stay another day or two? I said, yeah. That's awesome. So it doesn't hurt to let them know what you're thinking, as long as you do it subtle, you know, let them think, yeah, they made their minds, you know. You don't want to step on any egos.
So when you were presented the part of Eddie, was it presented to you as you were like the suave, more of the elegant one who can talk to authorities? Because I was telling, everybody had their jobs in terms of like the characters in the movie. You know, somebody was really good with computers.
I looked normal and I sounded normal for being foreign terrorist. You know what I mean? I was the American, you know, part of that group, you know, to be up front there. Yeah. Talk to Reginelle. And it is a Christmas movie. I say Merry Christmas in that movie to Reginelle when he's leaving.
Merry Christmas to you.
So that makes it official right there. And I didn't get killed in that movie either. I had a steel plate in my forehead from war. And when Bruce Willis shot me, it knocked me out. And when all the chaos and all the craziness, I got up and stuck to the original plan, stole an emergency vehicle and split. I've been down in South America now. I've been setting up here. I'm waiting to get revenge on John McClane in Die Hard 7.
Let's make this movie. I think that's a fantastic
movie. I'm sticking to it. It'd be better than some of that crap they've been coming up with.
Yeah, right. Well, speaking of Bruce, was it strange working with, you know, the two stars of the film, Alan Rickman, obviously a very successful stage actor and had done some television, but this is his first feature film, and Bruce Willis was, you know, a television actor more known for comedy. What was that like going in, knowing that the two leads weren't, you know, say, experienced film actors?
They didn't think they were too good for everybody else. That was perfect. You know what I mean? Alan Rickman's just a nice guy. He never changed from the time he, you know, and he looked up to me. Alan and I got along good. Matter of fact, we talked back and forth in England and stuff. We call one another, and he wanted me to be in one of his films, and I made a film called The Man in the Iron Mask, and I wanted him to be in mine, and we schedules didn't work out, but he's just an all-around great guy. I mean, he's just smooth. He was pushing Joel to get me to do that next film he did, the bar with Patrick Swayze, whatever it was, the bar movie.
Roadhouse.
Yeah, Roadhouse. But they even brought Swayze. I already knew Patrick. We were old friends. And they brought him out to the set to meet me, you know, the Die Hard set. And then when I got into the room with the director himself, and they put us like, because I stayed like, you know, 10 feet away from him, so he didn't see me towering over him, you know. And then when they put us in the room together, when there was no room to get away, you know, stand away from him, it was like I said, it's over. And it was. I was just too big, you know. It wouldn't have been believable.
Yeah. Now, the script was being not rewritten in the sense that any of the story was being changed, but it was being punched up for humor purposes. What was that like on set when you were you guys getting more comedic rewrites as you went along, and did you have to kind of learn any of those adjustments on the fly?
Yeah, but they were minor adjustments. You know, the script is there. I mean, I've got the original script over here in a box somewhere, but I mean, the original script is solid. And D'Souza came in, and he just, you know, he really beefed up the, you know, the humor, put the lines in, stuff like that, you know. And but they worked mostly with the, you know, with Bruce. You know, they didn't change my stuff much, you know, whatever it was. Matter of fact, some of that I had lived in the hallway there, because the director told me to. That was kind of a funny scene too, because it was the only one take scene in the whole movie, I swear, because we'd just come back from lunch about midnight or whatever it was, and we were all standing around waiting for Joel to show up, the producer, and John says, we just all stand there, and he goes, let's shoot one. I said, everybody said, yeah, let's do it. So I just walked, Reginald came up here anyway, and we walked through that whole scene, and I walked all the way up there and did all that talking. See, they cut it all up into pieces, you know, but it's all shot in one big long scene. You know, the walking, the talking, the whole thing, to go in and throw my feet up on the, my cowboy boots up on the counter there, and talking about the ball game and all that was, you know, we just did all that in one take. And so when we got done with that first take, that was just kind of like a run through practice day. John McTiernan says, that's it. You can't get it better than that. And so Joel shows up, and he's all excited. He's kind of an excited guy. And he's all like, come on, let's shoot this, whatever it is. And John looked over at him and kind of mouthed, we already got it, you know. And then Joel went, what do you mean? He goes, we shot it. It's good. So they all went over there, and they had a playback videotape, and it was actually videotape. And they ran it back and looked at it, and Joel went, that's it. You know, cut the set, let's move on, you know. And that's the only scene in that movie that they probably only had one take, because everything else, you know, they shot the hell out of it.
Right.
You know, like that scene where I got shot in the head, whatever it is, you know, at the end of the movie. The guy who had a blowgun, he had these wax capsules with, you know, red dye in them or whatever it was, and they'd hit you And then they bust, you know. Well, they sting when they hit, you know. And then you've got to clean the knee. And then you got to go hit the floor and do all that, you know, fly backwards and hit the floor. And the floor is hard. And at least the stunt guy was there, and he always lets me use his equipment. You know, they always go, just let Hayden do it.
Did you ever think, no pun intended for obviously what happens on the roof, but did you ever think this film was going to blow up as it did? I mean, I know you mentioned that, you know, this is going to be pretty successful, but I mean, this movie is, you know, huge in terms of popularity, you know, on so many people's list of top 100, sometimes top 10. Like, did you ever think this movie was going to be the cultural landmark that it was?
Yeah. I was at 20th Century Fox one afternoon after we'd finished the film. And I ran into John McTiernan and a couple of the high ups over there at 20th at the time. And John said, "Hey man, we're going to do a look at a rough cut of the movie," whatever it was. And there was about five of us. We went up and watched it. You know, a lot of the stuff wasn't even done yet, whatever it was. And just, we all walked out, and all the executive guys, they looked at me and they said, "How's it feel to be in a monster hit movie?" I said, "Hey, man." I said, "I got no arguments with you, man. It blew me away." You know, I mean, I was like, whoa. And then when I really saw it, when it had all the music and everything to it, then I was like, you know, it never failed not to be, from the writing, from the everything about it. You know what I'm saying? It just, it always had that feel, and it still does. I'm, you know, that's what we're talking about it today, you know, 32 years later.
Yeah. And when do you remember this film becoming kind of a Christmas tradition or staple or something that people watch all the time? You know, I talk to so many people, it's Christmas Story, It's a Wonderful Life, Die Hard, you know, that they watch it every year.
Yeah, I get calls every year this time of year. There's a theater up north just called me the other day and wanted me to come up. And for, you know, but Christmas is really good, you know. I didn't see it when that it was going to be this great Christmas movie, you know what I mean? That it is now. Now that part is the only part that surprised me. You know what I mean? That it did. But it really started that the first year. You know what I mean? When it made it all the way. It ran it when they opened it in July or something. It was still running. It was still knocking down stuff around Christmas time. You know,
it's kind of unheard of. You know, 5 months in and still running the theaters. That's, you know, you got a hit.
Yeah. It's an undeniable hit. Yeah.
I know you had mentioned that you had played this kind of role before, but after Die Hard, did you have any fear of typecasting, of being, you know, of a heavy, you know, in that kind of situation? Or was it just, hey, whatever the opportunity is, if it's good?
I would like to have had a lot more opportunity, but, you know, they at the time, everybody came out and thought I was Huey Lewis.
I've heard that.
Seriously, it was somebody in the LA Times or one of the big newspapers out there mentioned it in one of their reviews, said something about Huey Lewis did a killer job and did a Die Hard. And this was before, you know, cell phones and all that stuff. And I went around trying to get a bigger and better agents, you know, somebody that could get me some work. And most people didn't even believe me when I went in and told them that that's who I was and that stuff. You know, you couldn't run the film and then run the credits and go, "Oh, here, that's my name right there," you know what I mean? So he pretty much stole all that thunder, you know, right out of that, you know what I mean? But, you know, I had a lot of fun playing Huey Lewis, so what the hell?
Do you have a favorite role that you've done in your career?
I would say probably my favorite role would probably been the Man in the Iron Mask, the independent one with William Richard that I played D'Artagnan in. I had lots of good dialogue in there and it could show off, you know what I mean, what I can do. A lot of these bad guy stuff, they don't let you talk much, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But you know, there's another one called One Man's Army. We shot it in the Philippines. Jerry Trimble was used to shoot a lot of those Corman films, Roger Corman, and those kickbox fighter movies. And I went over there to play a bad guy because the guy who wrote the script wrote himself a, the writer wrote himself as the bad guy in the movie, and he was, I guess he was a cripple of some sort, you know, God bless him. But anyway, he got scared and didn't want to play the part, so they called me up to go over there and do it, and I flew over to the Philippines and met with the director, and he looked at me, and he looked at the, he just threw the script across this big table and said, I can't play you as a cripple. He goes, you're going to have to rewrite this script. So anyway, I rewrote the script while we were shooting the movie, whatever it was. And actually, they gave me some credit on that too. But that was fun. I got to play the lead in it, and I got to play a, there's, I read some reviews and said, if you've ever wanted to see an Academy Award winning performance in a B movie, check out Dennis Hayden in One Man Army.
So I think, you know, since I have the opportunity to talk with you here, I think we should finally put this debate to bed. And who better to end it than you? Is Die Hard a Christmas movie?
Die Hard is most definitely a Christmas movie. It's the number one Christmas movie of all time. What can I say?
There, you heard it. You heard it, folks. There's no more debate. Dennis has put it to rest. It is a Christmas movie. One, you know, hands down.
I don't care what Bruce Willis says about it. You know, he said that one interview he did, he said, well, they asked him if it was a Christmas movie when they were doing the roast or whatever it was, and he said, no, it's not. He just did that so it caused more controversy.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I thought that was a good move. Did you see the smile on his face when he said it?
Yeah. Dennis, I can't thank you enough. I really appreciate your time here. That was really illuminating and amazing stuff. And I can't wait to get this out and have people enjoy it as much as I did. So thank you. Well, I really appreciate it.
We can always do it again, too. We can more movies to talk about.
Absolutely, yeah. It's more than just Die Hard. So.
All right, John. Thanks, man. You have a great day and have a great holiday.
Yeah, you too. Yeah, to you and yours.
All right. Thanks.